Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and we are welcome to station number 5, and this is part 2 of what we can see from a superior view of the basicranium. So looking into the base of the skull, or where the brain would sit. And one of the most prominent things that we can see are going to be that the depth of the fossae in these regions are going to vary from anterior to posterior. So let's get our understanding of where the anterior, middle, and posterior cranial fossae will be located. The anterior cranial fossa will extend from the frontal bone right here back to the lesser wing of the sphenoid. So it'll be in this area right here will be the anterior cranial fossa. The middle cranial fossa is one of the more complex regions. It's going to extend from that lesser wing of the sphenoid to the apex or the top of the petrous part of the temporal bone. So this will be the middle cranial fossa. Right here, it also will have this central portion, which is the sella turcica, or that Turkish saddle region, where the pituitary gland will sit within the hypophyseal fossa. And then from the apex of the petrous part of the temporal bone back to the occipital bone will be the posterior cranial fossa. And it is this fossa that is the largest and the deepest because it will lodge not only parts of the brainstem, but also the cerebellum. So when we say kind of a staircase-like appearance, this would be the highest stair, the middle stair, and the lowest stair would be the posterior cranial fossa. We spent a considerable amount of time in the middle cranial fossa in the first part of the basicranium. So now we're going to talk about the few other things that we want you to locate in the anterior and the posterior, starting with the anterior cranial fossa. Right here, you're going to have what's referred to as the crista galli, and this will be important in terms of an attachment site for portions of the meninges. But on either side and of the ethmoid bone, you're going to have all these small foramina, just basically all over the place, right in this region. And these are referred to as the cribriform foramina, which basically means sieve-like because it appears like a sieve. And axons for olfactory cells that are from that olfactory epithelium are going to traverse this region, and these will form the olfactory nerves. So this will be important. This is going to be a component of the first cranial nerve. So it's not what we would typically think of as a nerve at this point. We're still talking the axons that are moving through this region until it will form the larger cranial nerve. Moving back to the posterior cranial fossa, this whole area right here that's kind of in between the middle and the posterior is the petrous part. So this whole complex right here is part of the petrous part of the temporal bone. This region will house not only the middle ear, but also the inner ear. And then the very top portion of the part that is going to project most superiorly will be the apex of the petrous part. And that's kind of that subdivision between the middle and the posterior cranial fossae. And this is difficult to see, but right around this region here, you will have what's referred to as the internal acoustic opening that leads into the internal acoustic meatus, similar to what we had on the external side. And this is going to lead into the middle and inner ear regions, and you will have two cranial nerves that will enter into this region. You'll have cranial nerve 7, which is the facial nerve. The facial nerve will enter into the middle ear region and then will eventually exit the skull. Whereas the other cranial nerve that's going to enter this region is cranial nerve 8, or the vestibulocochlear nerve. This will enter into the middle inner ear region and will never exit. So it's going to serve its function in that particular area. This area that is going to be between the temporal bone and the occipital bone is very oddly shaped. It's called the jugular foramen. When you have two, it's the jugular foramina. And these are the shape because it is at this point that we transition from the venous sinuses that are associated with the brain in the cranial region. At the point of the jugular foramen, it transitions into the internal jugular foramen, which is going to be a very dominant vein in the neck region on its way to the right atrium of the heart. You will also have cranial nerves 9, or glossopharyngeal, 10, or vagus, and 11, or the accessory nerve. And recall that accessory nerve is going to ascend from its origin on the spinal cord up through the foramen magnum and eventually will exit out of the jugular foramen. Just real quickly, this doesn't fit exactly within the basicranium view because you would have to actually go into the middle ear or that petrous part of the temporal bone. But you are going to have what's referred to as ear ossicles that are going to be located in the middle ear, and that is key here, middle ear, not inner ear or external ear. And these are the smallest bones of the body. The stapes is the smallest bone of the body. And these are going to be arranged this way from lateral to medial most. So the malleus is the lateral most. It is going to articulate with the tympanic membrane or the eardrum. The incus is intermediate. It will articulate with both the malleus and the stapes. And the stapes is the most medial, and it will articulate with the incus and also articulate with what's referred to as the oval window that leads into the inner ear. So you'll have sound waves that will kind of transmit through these bones or travel through these bones on their way to enter into the inner ear region. All right, excellent. So that is the second part of the basicranium. And please make sure that you review these materials. And if you have any questions, reach out. And thank you for your time and attention.